Here, over and over and over again, is that black people are mistreating Chinese people, is basically what you hear. So they don't have any reason to trust us.
Yeah, like African American people are always like ghetto, they're always doing bad stuff, and then
he actually got all his friends trying to beat me up, kept spraying him in the face, and I called the cops. There's like a group of people within the group that gives that group a bad name. We live in a nice part, but you go down a couple blocks and then it's not too good.
It's pretty dangerous. So just to walk down, to walk by yourself to the first door, there's people trying to sell coke or something.
With that in mind, I understand where it comes from. I feel that in every opportunity that I have to interact with Asians, I should make sure that it's a positive interaction. It's my responsibility. So that at least one person will have a different attitude about African Americans. My name is Ethel Haskins, and I'm a member of the Bay Area Christian Connection. And about 4 years ago, several ministers in the city of Oakland preached from the same scripture. And the scripture was about serving. And so when the pastor finished the sermon, he stood up and talked to the congregation about what are we gonna do? What service are we going to offer? And I just jumped right up and said, we're going to feed the people. We decided that we would collect food from the congregation. Whatever we got, we would give out the first of the next month. We did. We got enough food to give out to about 24 people. The next month, more than 50 people came. So then I realized that there was a very definite need in this area. We changed from monthly to weekly when we discovered from the Alameda County Food Bank that you could take as much produce as you could get rid of. And it worked out great. I mean, it works out great. We've developed some very good friendships. Many of the people that were in the line have volunteered to help us with the bagging and the food distribution. So that works out very well because I don't speak the language and they do, and it makes it very, very easy for us to get any kind of information that we want to pass through the line. When we start running out of a particular item, let people know. So if you've been standing in this line for a bag of oranges and we've run out of oranges, you need to know we've got our oranges. And so that kind of sharing of information has really been beneficial to us, to have the volunteers from people that are actually in the line. We are an evangelical covenant church. And we've been in that location for about 6-7 years. But it was a pretty bad shape when we bought it. They had, it had been broken into time and time again. People were sleeping there, staying there. They had boarded it up and tried their best to cut it off. And we got it. We got a group of volunteers and cleaned it up and ended up becoming our church. And as you can see now, you never ever imagined it was in that bad a shape. The Vietnamese Missionary Baptist Church shares space with us. They have there's a chapel upstairs, and they meet in that chapel every Sunday morning. And really, we get together a couple of times a year and have a shared meal. When our church was formed, we wanted to be a 7-day-a-week ministry. That there was something going on in that church every day. And that's pretty much is what's happening now. We have a a choir, a youth choir that meets there on Thursday when we're bagging food. They're over there singing. They have these beautiful little voices. And you can hear them singing. And then, of course, we have that Covenant Sisters program. That is, we have a foundation, the Bay Area Community Connection, that has gotten funding for this drug and alcohol rehab program for females, for women. And that has really been a blessing to the food program. The women just pitch right in and help. And in fact, it's like they've taken that program on as theirs. And when you watch them work, you can just see how much delight it brings to them to be able to help somebody else that has a need. Because they've all been in a bad place.
Michelle Baker.
How long have you been in the program?
30 days tomorrow.
Tell me a little bit about the program.
The program is Covenant Sisters, and we give food out as a community service project that we all do together.
Tell me about the food pantry ministry.
It's beautiful, you know. We get quite a bit of food. We've been blessed with a lot of food to have to give away. And on the day before, we bag it up. And we usually have volunteers help us, but mostly it's us. And then the following morning, we start at 9 o'clock and we give the food out.
How have your relationships developed with the various cultures out there? Tell me a little bit about that.
This is the first time I've ever had a lot of interaction with Asians, and I learned a lot about them. I learned that they are similar to us in a lot of ways. By us, I mean black people. But it was interesting, and I'm still learning from them.
Tell me, so since you're learning, there's some growth. Tell me, how have you grown in this particular program?
Well, I think I've become more compassionate for the elderly and, and more compassionate for people that's in need of food.
Out of our group of volunteers, we had to establish monitors along the way to watch for the cutting, and they were cutting in front of one another, just cutting in front of one another, and getting more and getting food before the end of the line had been served. So what we decided that the thing to do to monitor that would be for us to get armbands, but the armbands had to be put on so people we would know whether or not this person had been served that day. And when we ran out of, when the food got low, if you didn't have an armband, you couldn't. You could get a second bag if there were enough. But if you didn't have an armband, we wanted to serve everybody in the line. So they would just have to wait off to the side. Some of them would wait, some of them go get at the end of the line, start all over again, you know. But that was how it was said. Basically, we had to control the distribution of the food so that everybody that was in the original line got food. We were giving out food on the Wednesday. We were doing it on Wednesday then. We give it out on Friday now. The Wednesday before Christmas, the city team ministry on Washington Street was giving out toys that same day. So as the people came through the line, they saw this line of our food line. They came up basically to see what was going on. When they got to they saw the people in the line were Chinese. When they got to the door, they saw the people giving out the food were African American. So they just pushed the Chinese people out the way, got right in the front of the line and said, they don't do nothing for us. Why should we be doing anything for them? When someone called me and told me what was going on, I went outside to see what was happening, and this pretty much is what the lady said to me. They will never give us anything. I said, let me tell you something. I can't deal with anybody but myself. This program feeds everybody. We have plenty of food. All you have to do is just go to the end of the line, because you cannot crowd in front of them because you think that they don't have the right to have this food. This is a God's food program, And everybody in this line gets fed, regardless of who it is. They were, one guy really, really was irate, just profanely described to me what he thought about me and the fact that we were giving this food out to the Chinese people and wouldn't give it to him first. I told him if he went to the end of the line, he'd get his food. It was up to him, it was his choice, but he had to leave if he was gonna continue to be that profane. But it took a little while to make them understand that this we were God's people, dealing with God's people. And who they were didn't make any difference to us. God said, give food, that's what we were doing.
How are you? Hey! You fine? Yeah, go ahead.
Her name is Faith, and Faith is about, I think she's 90 years old. And at first we didn't get along, but then we became very close. She's not really able to speak English, but she does kind of understand it. And she used to hold my hand every time she came to get in line. And we communicate with like eyes, looking at each other, and kind of when I say something, then I can understand her with her movements. I can feel her. I can feel her thoughts. And she just smiles all the time. And I just, she's just a pretty lady. She's beautiful. It starts off, she's a lady that I exercise with. She comes, she exercises, and then she just likes to dance. She used to mess with me because I was kind of heavy. Well, I still kind of am, but she likes to mess with me like that. So we just start dancing, and we just like to enjoy ourselves. Yeah. We feel really good. We just enjoy being able to help these people and just, you know, make sure that their day's a little bit better.
Well, since I've been here, which has been about 30 to 40 days, the line used to be a little congested and used to be a little less havoc, so I developed a system where we get to the front of the line, we sort of slow them down, and the people in the line like that better than the bunching up thing and going in a rush. They like to take the time, so usually my first two times, I slowed the line down, stopped, and just sent a bunch of people up. It was kind of erratic, but when we came back the next week, everybody was like, okay, we're ready. You stop here. And they automatically just knew what to do. Instead of just going, I didn't have to keep on telling them. They just stopped. And they're all happy about it, because it's much easier. It makes the line more calm, and you can get through a lot faster than it's more or less of a system now. And they appreciate it.
Well, I recognize that a lot of the attitudes that exist between with the Asians and African Americans is propaganda that's kind of been just it furthered. I mean, the media just keeps making it even more pronounced. Even though, for instance, when the situation with the woman getting pushed out at the Muni station there. And the boy on Broadway or Telegraph there that jumped on the man and his son. Those kind of things are just the things that you heard over and over and over and over and over and over and over again, which is news. And I know it's their responsibility to share the news with you, but at the same time, I think they need to share. When they throw those negative things out there, they should share a positive story. You know, I mean. So what happens is all you hear over and over and over again is that black people are mistreating Chinese people is basically what you hear. So they don't have any reason to trust us. They basically think that we're all thieves and criminals. Chinese feel that way about African Americans. African Americans feel that they don't like us. And they come here and have advantages that we don't have and when we're born here. With that in mind, I understand where it comes from. I feel that in every opportunity that I have to interact with Asians I should make sure that it's a positive interaction. It's my responsibility. So that at least one person will have a different attitude about African Americans than they had before. Now, people don't follow me around in stores anywhere because I'm an old black lady and I don't figure that I'm going to be taking anything. But I do see it happening to other people. I really do. I see them watching youngsters, particularly black males. Black males get watched by everybody in the stores. So I really don't know. I think every one of us has the right to be the ambassador of one, where you do what you can to improve the situation. You have no intention of being in there to steal. It isn't necessary to be paranoid about the fact that they are following you around. Let them know that I'm in here to buy something. Help me. Okay?
As young adults, what can be done to better the relationships between cultures?
I think it's getting to like know one another and not just judge. I mean, I know that now a lot of people still see like the color, like, oh, you're a different color and stuff like that. I don't want to talk to you. I mean, you can still see, even though if they don't talk to you, like if you're just in the same room, and then you could tell by the way they look at you. But at the same time, like for me, I don't see like that. Like I could just get to know you, and like we could all get together as a group, as a community, and work together. Because at my school, we had a school, like a little program next to Casima, where all different races, all different colors would come and work together, like through music, like through your interests. So that was a good foundation, and I hope that continues to grow, because it brought a lot of different races together, and that's like the mainly like black people and like Hispanics working together. So it's a huge thing.
You guys, have you got anything
working? I'm seeing what I can do personally through like the music that I'm doing, like with my group of spirits in the basement. Like we've had certain like issues in the past, like with a certain rapper that I won't mention his name, but like we were networking with him, and like he was hooking us up with shows for a while, and then my friend read a post that he put on Facebook, like all you Mexicans and Asians and white rappers will never, you should just stop trying, because you'll never excel like black rappers or whatever, something like that. So like my friend just stopped working with him. And then like about a week ago or something like that, the dude hit up my friend, and he was like, so are you rolling with me? Are you riding with me or not? Are you gonna pay me this amount, like this much money, so that I could book you a show or not? Like it was something like, something really weird. And my friend hit him back up and was like, no, I'm doing okay. I mean, cause like, you know, in my rap group, we've got like, you know, black, Asians, white, like, you know, Mexicans, like whatever, like a Hispanic, like rappers. And we're doing pretty fine, you know, and we're doing pretty good. And I don't know, it's just, I think like overall, it's just, yeah, I don't know, it's engraved in people's heads. And I don't know exactly like how to go at it, but I'm gonna try to inspire, to influence the way I change it through the music. That's what I'm trying to do.
I think that we're at a point in time that's historic.
Oh yeah.
Whatever we do, we can be historic. You know, people can be writing about your relationship and what blossomed out of your relationships. There are so many people in history that are just like you and I, but they took the initiative. They seized the moment. And as Christians, it would be wonderful if Christians were able to bridge the gap between the cultures.
I think what we would like to see is a healthy Oakland. What I would like to see is 30, 40 years from now, a graying gentleman stops by and says, hey, thank you. I just wanted to come by because my grandparents or my parents were immigrants to America, and they came and they couldn't eat. And so my grandparents got food from your church every week, and now I'm a doctor. I'd love to hear that story. I'd love to hear the story of a child who says, you know, my father was incarcerated, and he came and he found hope here. My mother was on drugs. She came and she found hope here. And these are the stories that are growing today, and I'd like to see them fully lived out. It is in a small way, and not an insignificant way, how we change our world.
Oh, I received the Dorothy Height Community Service Award. I say I received it because my name was on the award, but I asked all of the Covenant sisters to go with me and ask them to stand with me when they acknowledged that the award, because it was centered around the food program for my community service to giving food to the community in the downtown area there.
This is the Dorothy Irene Height Award for Ethel Hart Haskins for outstanding leadership as a change agent in community service.
To God be the glory for the things that He has done.